Good morning and welcome to the third day of this mega Bharat Nutrition Week conclave. I am Kamal Narayan, CEO of Integrated Health and Wellbeing Council, India's premier institution for health awareness, advocacy, and behavior change. As an institution, it has been a constant endeavor of ISW Council to create strong advocacy for anything and everything that concerns the people's health through campaigns, forums, and public movements. The second edition of Bharat Nutrition Week is one such major initiative that brings together policymakers, experts, clinicians, social influencers, public, and even children through a series of thought-provoking activities. Nutrition through good food is the basis of a healthy life, and any imbalance in it can lead to poor health consequences. Bharat Nutrition Week, which happens alongside the National Nutrition Month, takes India's nutrition imbalance head on and tries to find the root causes and implementable solutions to the problems. So let us take a look at the highlights of the first 2 days of this movement. Welcome to the second day of this mega Bharat Nutrition Week conclave.
The importance of having proper nutrition is really fundamental to country's development.
India is struggling to address the issue of malnutrition for a long time. And even the Honorable Prime Minister has given so much of priority.
The problem of nutrition is very, very high in India. We are facing a triple burden of disease.
We have to own the responsibility on ourselves as specialists, doctors, healthcare providers of all cadres. What are we doing about it?
Today, the average person is far more informed about nutrition than ever before.
When we talk of nutrition, we should think of two things: nutrition to the body and nutrition to the brain. They cannot be separated.
Eating nutritious food is important at every age. But when it comes for children, a healthy diet with right serving sizes and proper nutrition, it's important for growth and development.
This is day two and we are playing South Zone with the theme immunity. All right, we have anemia fighters at 20 points, DC champions at 30 points, calcium warriors at 30 points, immunity boosters at 20 points, health crusaders at 20 points, and we have a winner with us today with Protein Kings at 40 points.
Awesome, Protein Kings!
I'm making a classic hummus and I'm making a pumpkin version of it as well. Here's a classic hummus.
Today, we have experts to discuss how food can help prevent or reduce the risk of non-communicable and chronic diseases. Yes, you heard it right. Food can help prevent or reduce the risk of non-communicable and chronic diseases. And it is one of the most urgent priorities of India, as health problems like cardiovascular diseases, cancer, chronic respiratory diseases, and diabetes are estimated to account for around 60% of all deaths in our country. India launched the National Program for Prevention and Control of Cancer, Diabetes, Cardiovascular Diseases, and Stroke in 2010. While it focuses a lot on strengthening infrastructure, human resource development, health promotion, early diagnosis, management, and referral, little is mentioned about the role of food and nutrition in preventing and controlling these diseases. The World Health Organization recognizes food system as a critical tool to prevent NCDs. That means just by taking the right amount and right type of food, and also by junking fast foods and fizzy drinks, we can control a substantial burden of such diseases. We have seen how many other countries, including those from our neighborhood, have adopted innovative approaches to nudge and encourage people towards healthier food choices. Sri Lanka pioneered a traffic light labeling system for all beverages sold since 2016, creating a simple way for consumers to be aware of the sugar content in pre-packaged drinks and make informed decisions about consumption. That year, Maldives hiked taxes on energy and soft drinks by 58%, while India has also adopted steps like reducing the amount of trans fat permissible in food products to 5%, more consumer-friendly measures facilitating decision-making are indeed the need of the hour. So to discuss the various aspects of food, nutrition, and disease control, and how we can lay the strong foundation for making an Ayushman Swasth Bharat by ensuring a portion yukt society, we have an extraordinary panel of acclaimed experts today with us. So let me welcome Ms. Sujaya Krishnan, former Joint Secretary, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India. Ms. Krishnan is a member of the Board of Advisors at White Swan Foundation for Mental Health and a member of the Executive Committee, Institute of Peace Research Action, IPRA, New Delhi. During her stint with the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, she was in charge of the National Mental Health Program, National Program for Healthcare of the Elderly, and National Program for the Preventive and Control of Blindness and Deafness, Oral Health, and Fluorosis. We also have with us Professor Dr. Chitranjan Yajnik, Director of Diabetes Unit at the King Edward Memorial Hospital and Research Center in Pune. He is well known for his description of thin fat Indian, which describes that though not obese by international criteria, Indians are adipose, high body fat percentage. Dr. Yajnik specializes in intrauterine programming of diabetes and has demonstrated a possible role for maternal micronutrient nutrition in its etiology. He is a founder, member, and vice president of Society for Natal Effects on Health in Adults, India, and a founder member of the International Developmental Origins of Health and Disease Society. Dr. Yajnik is an advisor to many national and international organizations, including Department of Biotechnology, Indian Council of Medical Research, National Institute of Nutrition, WHO, FIGO, which is Federation International of Gynecology and Obstetrician and Obstetrics, and the Wellcome Trust, London. We also have with us Dr. Jagmeet Madan, Principal and Professor at the Department of Food, Nutrition and Dietetics, SVT College, SNDT University, Mumbai. Dr. Madan has served as National Vice President of Indian Dietetics Association, India, representative of ASEAN Federation of Dietetic Association. She is a part of the expert group working on ASEAN and Indian consensus statement and guidelines on obesity, diabetes, cardiovascular diseases, and physical activity at the national level. She is a core member of FSSAI, the National Food Regulatory Body. Dr. Madan is also gold medalist and recipient of the Young Scientist Award and Dr. Ramnathan Award by the Nutrition Society of India, National Institute of Nutrition in Hyderabad. We are also joined by Dr. Sanjay Kinra, head of the Non-Communicable Diseases Epidemiology Department, London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine. Dr. Sanjay has research interest in the area of diet-related NCDs in India and some other low-middle-income countries. He works on cohort study to understand the local risk factors of NCDs and conducts clinical trials to test preventive and management strategies. He's joining us this morning from UK. Thank you so much, Dr. Sanjay, for joining us. Last but not the least, we have Dr. Monica Arora, Director of the Health Promotion Division and Professor at the Public Health Foundation of India. Dr. Arora is a public health scientist working in preventive and managing non-communicable diseases through health promotion and health advocacy. She has been involved in public health research, practice, and training for over two decades. Dr. Arora is currently a board member of NCD Alliance Geneva and co-chair of the Global Research Network of the Society for Research on Nicotine and Tobacco. She has also been a member of various national and international expert committees on NCDs and adolescent health formed by the World Health Organization and the Government of India. So thank you so much, all our esteemed speaker, for joining us this morning on this very critical discussion about how we can build a healthy India by ensuring something so essential as nutrition, food, which is very basis of life. So let me begin with Ms. Sujaya Krishnan. Madam, you have been part of the policy making when it comes to the health system of our country. We have seen there has been a substantial emphasis on nutrition for women and children, and especially during the first 1,000 days, and rightly so, as it, you know, is very, very critical to ensure that we have impact of the life course in terms of better health outcomes. But how do you see the need of taking a overall life course approach when it comes to role of nutrition in better health outcomes of the country? And especially when we see that the NCD burden has been ever growing, did the health policies of a country try to integrate this aspect over the period?
Good morning, everybody. I'm very happy to be among this distinguished panelists. And I think this event happens at a very important time. I think it's quite significant. Now, as Kamal rightly said, I think the world is talking about the concept of basic life course approach, the continuity of human lives from fetus to old age, from the womb to the tomb. And studies are revealing clearly a strong effect of the influence of the womb in the womb on the future manifestation of chronic diseases. Nutrients and physical activity influence gene expression and may define susceptibility. The major biological and behavioral risks emerge and act in early life and continue to have a negative impact throughout the life course. The known risk factors are now recognized as being amenable to alleviation throughout life, even into old age. Similarly, the effects of man-made and natural environment and the interaction between the two on the development of chronic diseases is increasingly recognized. The continuity of influences contributes to the development of these diseases, but also affords opportunities for its prevention. As increasing evidence is thrown up that chronic diseases risks begin in adult life and continue into old age. A continuation of physical activity, food variety, and extensive social interaction is the most likely lifestyle profile to optimize health and reflected in increasing longevity and healthy aging. Now, even in sync, among adult population in India, the association has been clearly found between impaired glucose levels and high Pondreal index, that is fatness at birth. There is similar advice that among term and preterm babies, breastfeeding is associated with significantly lower blood pressure levels in childhood. The tracking of high blood pressure in children and adolescents have shown a background of unhealthy lifestyles, including excess intake of saturated fats, cholesterol, and salt, and inadequate intakes of potassium and reduced physical activity. While there is real concern today about the early manifestation of chronic diseases, on the positive side, I think there is also evidence that they can be corrected. And this is where the role of each of us present here today and out there hearing us comes in. The changing, and I think if you look at the patterns of nutrition is in the world, is linked to globalization. Global diet is going through a remarkable transition. Staple foods are getting more refined and processed. Fat and meat intake is increasing. Processed dietary products and other processed foods are consumed more than before, and larger number of meals are eaten outside the home, making households more reliant on the food industry, food vendors, and food markets. The dietary transitions are associated with the escalating trends in NCDs. Now, if you look at the dietary globalization, usually increases the variety in the traditional, formerly monotonous diets, and thus improve the energy and nutrient adequacy. At the same time, I think care needs to be taken that we do not ape too much into the Western terms in terms of substantial increases in the intake of fat, especially saturated fat, refined carbohydrates, but they stay prudent and health promoting, I would say. This is a challenge in a world where malnutrition, fast food companies aggressively look for new markets. But with well-planned interventions and persistent efforts, the adverse trends can be modified. In developing countries like ours, both the NCDs and the MDG agenda need to be a part of healthy policy dialogue. Low birth weight and malnutrition in the first 1,000 days of life contribute significantly to diabetes and cardiovascular problems in later life. Hypertension and diabetes later in life. Smoking, alcohol intake potentially increases the chances of developing other and effectiveness of treatments. A number of small proven preventive measures can stem the rise of NCD epidemic. Data indicate the potential of affordable, potent preventive tools focused on 5 key areas, which would be basically, we are talking today about food, but when we talk about NCDs, we need to talk in terms of tobacco, alcohol, diet, exercise, and nutrition. And nutrition probably is the most important when we say about it. Together, programs could reduce the burden of NCDs. By more than half, significantly a tiny fraction of the many of the drivers of NCD are outside the remit of the health sector. What can then be the role of the health sector in NCD prevention? Health is the only sector with the mandate to approach health issues from the holistic point of view. The health sector must play a central role in NCD prevention and in the efforts and mitigation efforts. Because successful prevention involves multi-sectoral actors, the country needs to adopt a framework that clearly sets out the different levels of accountability for each role player. Changes towards promoting and need to be greatly expanded as an integral part of that intervention. Ways to reduce intake of sugar-sweetened drinks, particularly by children, of high energy density fats that are micronutrient poor, as well as efforts to curb cigarette smoking and to increase physical activity, will have an impact throughout society. Such changes need to have the active participation of communities, politicians, health systems, town planners, municipalities, as well as the food and leisure industries. Marketing of fresh fruits, vegetables at competitive prices, including cold storage, subsidized transport, would see interventions of departments, including agriculture, food and supply, transport, etc. Food labeling for multinutritional information. That is, whether it's biscuits, when you talk, say, information about the calories, about the trans fats, etc., that would require action by the FSSAI. Ban on, say, unhealthy choices like tobacco and junk food in schools would see action by the ministries of information broadcasting, health, education department, mass awareness through Prasar Bharati and Doordarshan would all be examples of intersectoral actions. I think the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare is engaged in mainstreaming research and training on alternative crops, livelihoods, and economics of tobacco control with the other nodal ministries. In addition, research on critical and cross-cutting issues like alternative livelihoods for people engaged in the tobacco sector, alternative cropping system, taxation as a tool for tobacco control are being taken up to build scientific evidence. Through the advocacy workshop, the tobacco control issue has gone beyond the Ministry of Health to other stakeholders, departments such as police, education, customs, excise, information, broadcasting, agriculture. So if, and they've also notified many of these people from these agencies as law enforcers. Multi-sectoral actions in India definitely impacted on the choices made and demanded by the people, such as labeling of contents, ban on junk foods in schools and colleges, college canteens, I would say, smoke-free zones in public places, closure of tobacco shops near schools and colleges, and providing an environment conducive to good health and mental well-being. Partnerships among government, civil society, private sector can become a reality in the health sector for preventing NCDs and promoting healthy lifestyles. Engaging the target audience and a true sense of partnership among stakeholders would facilitate and complement the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare's efforts in prevention of NCDs and high visibility in the mass media, say ever through clear messages, practical strategies to definitely be the way forward.
Thank you so much.
I would also say, besides establishing high level of political, I think, besides high level of political commitment, just one point, strong legislation, regulation, community and industry partnerships, effective implementation of national policies and programs through capacity building, training of human resources, and sustained awareness would among, and the common vision among all stakeholders to promote a healthy and happy India would be the need of the hour.
Thank you so much, Ms. Sujaya. You know, wonderful, actually, I think the beginning of this discourse, because you have in a way captured the entire, food system, which is very, very important when we are looking at that, how nutrition play a role in either prevention or in, as a causative for diseases. And, you almost echoed the whole essence of Bharat Nutrition Week also. In these 7 days, we tried to look into the whole life course approach, starting from, the maternal and child health, which we spent first 2 days, apart from the broad, discussion on how overall, nutrition plays an important role in the health of the people. And also we are going to, by the 6th and 7th day, we are going to look into the role the industry, what role the agriculture sector plays, how are, the crop pattern has changed, which is also has, bearing on what kind of food are people eat at present time. So you have mentioned, and the good part that you have very, I think, emphatically highlighted that the silver lining here is that all this can be changed. The burden of non-communicable diseases can be prevented a lot by making the right kind of modifications. Thank you so much for this, for your, these points. Let me go to Dr. Professor Chitranjan Yajnik. Professor Yajnik, you have, been, as I said, that we have been discussing and getting a lot of inputs and, experts talking about how by, ensuring that the first 1,000 days of life, and especially, immediately post you know, conception. And not only that, even beyond that, you know, having the right health for our adults and girls who can, you know, grow into a healthy women and then go for healthy pregnancy. All that is important. And, you know, you have been working a lot on the natal effects of health in adults. And, you know, so first of all, I would like to understand a bit more, and I'm sure it is going to help our audience also, what this, you know, thin fat theory is all about. And also, how do you see that by ensuring that, you know, that first 1000 days nutrition, we can actually build a very, you know, healthy society, which can be productive across the life course.
Thank you. Thank you, Kamal. Okay, the thin fat idea, as Madam explained, the Indians look thin and they are not obese by the body mass index criteria, which internationally have given us certain cut points for overweight and obesity. But if you measure body fat as body fat, then they are adipose. And I first noticed this when I was a student in the BJ Medical College in 1970s. So I was supposed to look after diabetes clinic patients, and I used the measurements to calculate their BMI, which was a very new thing in 1970s. And I found that our patients were very different than what the textbooks were describing. They were much, much thinner. But even in 70s, in the Sassoon Hospital where I trained, diabetes clinic was the most populated specialty clinic. There were lots of patients. Subsequently, I went to UK for training and learned about a skinfold calipers, which measures the subcutaneous fat. Either you measure it or biceps, triceps, or subscapular. And then the answer came. When I compared patients in Sassoon with patients in Oxford, where I trained, the Indian patients had a body mass index which was 5 units smaller, but their subscapular skin fold was actually higher than the English patients. So this is how the story began in adults. People found it very difficult to accept the term, so I ended up publishing my picture with my English friend. We both had similar body mass index of 22.3, but John Yudkin had a body fat percent of 9.1%, and yours truly had a body fat percent of 21%. This was 25 years ago. Now, my fat is unspeakably high. Then we started thinking, and everyone said, this must be genetic. Now, clearly, everything is genetic to an extent, but we wanted to see whether there might be something preventable. And when I learned from David Barker about intrauterine origins of susceptibility of diabetes, I made special attempts to measure the babies in great detail. And when we compared the babies born in Pune with babies born in Southampton, where David Barker and Caroline Fall work, our two major collaborators, we found that Indian baby was only 2.7 kg, as opposed to English baby, which was 3.5 kg. So a whopping 800 grams lighter. But the Indian baby's subscapular skin fold again was very similar to the English baby. So we went on and used more advanced techniques like DEXA, then especially MRI, that's the magnetic resonance imaging, to show that Indian babies had more fat, especially inside and outside the abdomen, compared to the English babies. And then came interesting thing, we measured blood chemistry in the cord blood of the Indian babies. And that showed that Indian babies had a dysfunction of this adipose tissue. They had higher leptin but lower adiponectin, which is a protective hormone secreted by the fat cells. So all our Lalat Rekha, which is written here, is present at birth. And then we, of course, make it worse over a period of time. So we went on to show that babies which were born smaller but had grown bigger by 4 or 8 years of age, had the highest number of diabetes and cardiovascular risk factors. So if you are born small and become big, if there is a discrepancy in your growth rate in utero and subsequently, that's a bad combination. This went on, and then we showed a role for vitamin B12 and folate imbalance in the mother during pregnancy, which increased the risk of diabetes in the baby. All this was happening when a lot of molecular biology advances were happening. And very soon we learned that this is epigenetic. This is not genetic alone. This is epigenetic, which are modifications introduced by the environment on your DNA. And the most important window in which what we call epigenetic reprogramming happens in the baby is within 48 to 72 hours of conception, even before mother knows she is pregnant. The whole epigenome is reprogrammed, and therefore your pre- and periconceptional health of the mother, which of course strongly includes nutrition and metabolism, decides what the baby will grow like, what will be its size and shape, what will be its systems, what will be its structure, what will be its function, and this remains with you for the rest of the life. So very usefully, now we have extended the 1,000 days concept because it excludes preconceptional period. That's a major lacuna in the thinking in 1,000 days. It includes pregnancy and first 2 years. So we now include preconception. So we say extended 1,000 days concept. And that is what I think drives what happens to that individual for the rest of the life. It's never too early. It's never too late. You will get benefit by starting earlier. But it's not that you will not get benefit by starting later. So like Madam said, in children, in young adults, in older people, something will always be achieved. And important to remember, it is intergenerational. So mother's health affects the baby's health. And it can be transgenerational. So grandmother's health can help influence the granddaughters and grandsons health. And I'm going to tell you an interesting thing here, which is quite striking. When a mother is pregnant with a female child, the female child has all the 1 million ova which it will possess in the rest of the life by 20 weeks of gestation. So grandmother's health is influencing the ova which are going to develop into third generation. So this is a unique opportunity. This is transgenerational, one step ahead of intergenerational. And all these exciting things in biology have now actually made the pathway clear for us. And I think Indian government's various schemes, which are related to adolescent health, pregnancy, children, ICDS programs, name it, have a new meaning in terms of international, intergenerational and transgenerational health in the DOHAD model, the developmental origins of health and disease. So that's what my take is. That's what I come from. And I have to say David Barker taught me these things. So that was amazing. On a February morning in 1991, in 15 minutes, he changed my career. So instead of being an adult diabetologist investigating genetics and environment in adults, I became an investigator of pregnancy and the related issues. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Professor Yajnik. You know, I'm not a science student. I'm a health enthusiast, but I just, you know, feel amazed when I hear these, you know, miracles of biology that, you know, how the whole life course and its health can be decided in first 24 hours of conception, as you said. So wonderful. You're saying something.
No, that's right. I said thank you for conveying this message. And someone like you is crucial in popularizing this concept.
Thank you so much. So this thin fat, which you quite detailed in details you describe, what can be the causes of that? So let me go to before I go to Dr. Sanjay, let me go to Dr. Jagmeet Madan. Dr. Madan, is it the food habits of Indians which is contributing to it? We know that we, despite producing, I think, the maximum and being a major producer of vegetables, fruits, animal and, milk produces. I think we are quite a big producer of protein as well, but our population is protein deficient. Is it these food patterns which is leading to this thin fat scenario or phenomenon which Professor Yasnik just described?
Yes. At the outset, thank you very much, Mr. Kamal, for giving this opportunity. I'm really privileged to be a part of this esteemed panel. Just a minor correction in my introduction. I am the national president of Indian Dietetic Association from January 2019. I think we owe a lot to Dr. Yasnik for treading the path and bringing such starking facts to the Indian population, which are so true to Indian population. Taking that thread forward, to my mind, when we are talking about the nutrition through life cycle, the most important phase is the adolescence and young adult, because that's the future of India. And I am most concerned because when I talk to you, we have just finished analyzing data of 1300 adolescents and young adults of 16 to 25 years in the city of Mumbai. And you'll be astonished to learn that 29% of them are already pre-diabetics. But the ironical situation is that they are all having low BMI and normal BMI. And if I look at their dietary pattern, there is complete lacuna of quality nutrition. So the problem with this age group is that nutrition is a low priority. It is never a priority to them. Number two, they believe in snacking. Meals are not a concept with adolescents and young adults. And when it comes to snacking, they are absolutely on the high fat, salt, sugar foods. And there is no concept of how to get quality, even if you are snacking. So somewhere,
seems there is some signal problem with Dr. Madan. Dr. Madan, am I audible to you? Is Dr. Madan
internet? The connection is gone, I think.
Yes, yes.
The picture is frozen.
Please assist Dr. Madan if she can reconnect. Let me go to Dr. Sanjay in between. Dr. Sanjay, I was, when reading out your introduction, I was, pleased to see that you are specifically doing, research on the epidemiology and etiology of, NCDs among Indians. We in, nearly 6 million people, kind of are dying in India because of NCDs. And as I said, it is, almost more than half of the total deaths we see. Plus, there is a massive burden of diseases and consequent loss of economy, apart from you know, the deaths or the mortality. How much can it be blamed for the lack of right nutrition? Dr. Yajnik has almost, you know, answered this, but apart from, you know, what is already coded in our genes, you know, by our parents or our grandparents, what is it that we are contributing to it towards whether we are going to have a healthier life or a life, you know, kind of bogged down with so many NCDs, which we are seeing quite a, you know, massive burden which the country is facing here. So, and how much of it can be changed actually, if it is, you know, the food which is many times causing this, how much of it can be changed? And this is what I think Dr. Ms. Sujaya also at the very beginning said, that the good part is that we can correct it. And Dr. Yajnik also said that, you know, it's never too early and it's never too late. So how we can change this course, what we are, you know, kind of inherited and at the same time adding to it. Sir, you are on mute.
Okay, can you hear me now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so thank you for inviting me, Kamal, and posing this question. So I think starting with your question around how much can we blame on diet, I mean, just the first thing to say that, you know, cardiovascular diseases will always be, NCDs will always be there, and people will have to die somehow. But it's more about the prematurity of these conditions, getting those at an earlier age that we want to reduce. So we all live as long as possible, and eventually we will get some conditions. So I think it's true to say that diet is probably one of the diet, and to some extent tobacco are probably two of the biggest killers. Activity plays a big role, but it's more towards some of the other health condition and about the fitness side of things. But probably it's fair to say that diet plays a huge role in NCDs and cardiovascular disease. And in that respect, we've got overnutrition at later ages of life, and as Dr. Yajnik said, undernutrition at early ages of life. So in terms of adults, I think Dr. Krishnan already talked about, you know, all the different elements of poor diet, like too many calories, too much saturated trans fats, sugars, processed food, less fruit and veg, and those kind of issues. So they all clearly contribute. But then coming to your second question around how much can it be changed? So I think it's true to say that it's not easy to change. I don't want to demoralize anybody, but globally, countries have struggled to change these things. Of course, when we try to change, let's say, diet or lifestyle, for example, it's a combination of individual behaviors and as well as environmental changes that policymakers can facilitate. So I do some work on behavior science and things, and we've been finding that it's very hard to actually change people's behaviors, especially at an individual level. So there are some tips and guidance you can give people on how to manage their diet or weight and things, and those tips can help some people. But to a large extent, we get driven by the environment in which we're in. And Dr. Yajnik says some of the early life programming that happens both at a biological level, but maybe also at a behavior level, where you grow up in a certain environment as children, adolescent, you're forming certain habits that stay lifelong. So I think this is where individuals can do a little bit, probably households can do even more. And this is where, you know, agencies such as yours, who are very focused on improving information sources and other ways of providing that individual education and behavior change science to people, can be helpful to some extent. But as Dr. Krishnan said, to a large extent, the solution will lie with policymakers. And she very clearly elucidated all the, you know, the range of modalities. And I think you also mentioned in your video that could be taken forward. It's often difficult for policymakers, I have to grant them then, because they have to trade off different pressures that they face from the politics, from different interests. But I think all the evidence shows that it's the environment that drives this. There's some amount of research now happening on built environment, and increasingly research happening on the financial environment, for example. That seems to be, so there's a whole range of financial mechanisms like taxes, subsidies, incentives that can be used. And we know that, you know, price, especially in India, as in anywhere else, is a big driver when you go shopping and what you choose to buy. To give you a small example, we've just finished a study in a cohort study that I run in Telangana. We work with 29 villages near Telangana, near Hyderabad in India. And it's normally a cohort study to look at long-term risk factors of NCDs and diet in India. But we just finished a trial of a financial incentive scheme. So the idea was that in high-income countries like USA, for example, a lot of research has been done with supermarkets, you know, how you can position the goods in supermarket or by giving discounts or rewards to people shopping in supermarket. And that can change people's behavior, especially towards fruit and vegetable purchasing, which is a big problem in the US, for example. So we tried to do a similar study in India, but in rural India. And as you can imagine, we don't have the kind of scanner model or, you know, some checkout scheme and a card being used, because most of the shopping is happening with those old ladies with the fruit and vegetable basket selling in the middle of the village every evening and people doing the shopping. So you can't apply the same models. But we were able to devise a scheme where people had these reward cards or vouchers. So every time they did shopping and shopped for over 100 rupees, they could get a stamp. And if they collected enough, like going to a coffee shop in a city in Mumbai or somewhere, if you collect 400 rupees worth of stamp, you get a 100 rupee bonus or a discount at the end of it. So you get the reward. And we are just in the process of writing this publication now. But I can tell you now that we found quite a substantial effect in people changing their habits even after the scheme ended for us. I mean, we were able to, it was supposed to be a long study, but we had to cut it short because of the COVID now, and the new wave came in Telangana, so we couldn't carry on for very long. But we were able to continue for a period of time at the end of the program. And the villages in which we had the scheme operating, they were still buying more fruit and vegetable as opposed to other villages where the scheme was not in place. So it was a randomized trial that we conducted out to get high quality evidence. So it seems like even in these kind of informal food economies, it's possible to try these kind of sophisticated economic instruments, which probably are going to be, and those can be applied at any stage of life, of course, even for adults, but even for early life programming type of issues. In the end, you have to change the household behaviors, especially at the point of purchasing or consuming food goods. So that's just a plea for, I think we've just done one of the first studies, but clearly, you know, this is just one study. So a lot more research along these lines where we act at a higher environmental upstream drivers, as people call them. This is where I think where the money will lie, if you like, in terms of being able to change things more easily rather than just relying on the individual and their own, you know, mental and psychological power to make change happen. So I'm going to stop here now. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sanjay. I'll go back to Dr. Jagmeet and Dr. Dr. Jagmeet, while your connection had a problem, actually we got a good insight from Dr. Sanjay also. Though he said that not a lot can be changed when it comes to, you know, mitigating and reducing or, you know, kind of preventing. But at the same time, he also said that certainly food has a major impact on our health and the kind of diseases we get. So you were, you know, completing your point at that time, you know, that the new generation is more snack oriented rather than, you know, for meals. And my point was that even if it meals, you know, like people like us, we go for three times of meal every day, mostly home cooked, but it's still, that nutritional literacy or the composition of food many times is not towards what it should be. And that has become a part of our life, and it has been a kind of been a practice maybe for generations. So how is it that Indian, because what I see that food was always given a very central importance in Indian culture, you know, right from the kind of grains we grew maybe in past. It is growing, it is changing. Dr. Sujaya also said that a lot of those crop patterns have changed over the period. Finer grains we are shifting to, but is it that we have always been consuming unhealthy, or it has become largely a new phenomena, and what can be the changes brought in at a public level, at a family level, at an individual level, and at the same time a policy level also?
So I think Dr. Kamal, first of all, apologies. My institution is very close to the airport, and we have planes taking off every few minutes. So somewhere these unpredictable breaking of the network happens. So my take from here is that there are two keywords very important in an Indian scenario. Number one is quality nutrition, and number two is portion control. Now, the most important statement which I want to make is that we have to accept Indians as Indians, right? So which means if Indians are carb people, they cannot leave their carbohydrates. So the solution to that is, to take them towards quality nutrition is to introduce them to quality carbohydrates, which not only comes from rice and wheat. In fact, there are millets, there are so many other roots and tubers, so many pulses, which also give you, oligosaccharides or resistant starches, or the kind of carbohydrate which is really good for your metabolic health. So one is introducing them to good quality carbohydrate by giving them more choices. And when I say choices, an Indian is not a simple population. There is so much of ethnic, variation, and we are talking about portion for local. So I think the role of a nutritionist in today's time is, one is penetration across India. And being the national president of Indian Dietetic Association with a presence in 25 chapters across India, I think there is a lot of strength to reach out to each and every Indian across the states. And what we need to do is to look for quality nutrition options, whether it is good quality carbohydrate, whether it is, good options for plant proteins, whether it is good quality fat. And we ourselves have done, research and created evidence in an Indian scenario that the moment you increase on the intake of the quality carbohydrate, the moment you increase the intake of good quality fat with a portion control, I think let's not forget. And I think what has really emerged in the recent past is the healthy plate concept. I think that's one concept. If you make an Indian understand that when you serve food to yourself, see to it, ask yourself the first question, where is the dietary fiber in my plate? So look at how much quantity of vegetable are you taking? What type of vegetable are you taking? Is it local? Is it seasonal? Is it colored? Is half of it is in the form of salad, half is lightly cooked, not pav bhaji or navratan korma. And one quarter of your plate is definitely having some protein, whether it is plant protein, maybe it's a katori of dal, whether it is a katori of curd, whether it is an egg. So one quarter of plate has to be protein, and it's only one quarter, one fourth of your plate has to be cereal or a staple or a starch, which again has to be of good quality. So whether you take millets, whether you increase the quantity of millets or take brown rice, or go for some of the roots which are high in resistant starches. So somewhere, if we drive simple messages and give people, economical, affordable, local options and support it with very aggressive nutrition literacy. See, how is it that a child, you know, memorizes the song of a film song? You don't have to teach the child because it's bombarded all the time, you know, and they just pick up. So the same job has to be done by today's nutritionists in every nook and corner of this country. And I'm so happy that we are working very closely with FSSAI and Government of India. And this government has actually taken nutrition to the center stage. And that is where, you know, National Nutrition Mission, Poshan Abhiyan, and the kind of endeavors like making Nutrition Week to a Nutrition Month. I think that in itself kind of communicates the priority the government wants to give to the nutrition. But it has to become into an action format wherein, we use all possible measures. And this pandemic has brought all of us very close to the virtual platforms, you know, whether it's Twitters or Instagram or Facebook. And again, you know, using vernacular languages and reaching people and bombarding the same messages again and again and giving solutions to people. I think there is no point in just talking generic. We have to break those generic statements into solution, into action points, and give those solutions to people in this country.
Thank you so much, Dr. Madan. Important points you have highlighted. And I just take that one line that, you know, kind of driving these simple messages to the people. And when we need to drive these messages, let me go to Dr. Monica Arora. Dr. Arora, you have been involved in health promotion, and in health promotion, nudging people for the right kind of healthy behavior or choices, an important aspect. How easy it is to, you know, write these simple messages, because Dr. Madan described about Indian Thali, and somehow Indian Thalis have now only been seen in some, kind of traditional restaurant, and it is no more in a family. They all have been replaced by plates, and we don't see this kind of composition of multiple things. And at the same time, I think the lifestyle, and not only the need to work, and I think all the adult members of the families need to work, and they don't have time for this much diligence. I think how we can actually drive these simple messages that food is everyday's requirement, and it is basis of your you are what you eat, but at the same time I think food is something which gets the minimum attention from the people, apart from taste or the choice of whether we are going to have Italian, Chinese, or maybe continental. Today we hardly think about that, what is in it, in the food.
Thank you so much. The earlier speakers have highlighted very important points, and I will want to highlight that we need to look at determinants of behavior change. Whenever we are talking about health promotion, all the interventions which are given, we have to understand these have to be theory based. What happens in many interventions is we feel that we put up one poster and that will lead to nutrition education, nutrition literacy, and it will change people's behavior, which usually does not happen. As Dr. Jagdish Madan mentioned, it has to be reinforced. You know, behavior change happens when there is reinforcement of messages. So if a child gets a message in the school environment or through media about healthy eating, this has to be reinforced every week. This is what we have seen in our research interventions. When we gave intervention for 2 years, that is where we saw that students started changing their behavior, started eating more fruits and vegetables. However, this intervention was again designed taking inputs from those students. So community engagement is very important, understanding your audience, before designing the intervention and making an intervention which they understand, the jargon they understand. Many a times we lose that important communication piece and use the language which they do not identify with. So intervention has to be designed following a behavior change communication theory. It should be over a period of time, not one-off messages. A morning assembly lecture or just one advertisement on television will not change their behaviors. They have to continuously hear these messages. And after 2 years, we saw that sugar-sweetened beverage consumption went down. Their behaviors on choosing fruits and vegetables went up voluntarily, as well as important is also physical activity. So their physical activity hours increased, and sedentary behavior, which is the new risk factor we all are worried about and has increased a lot during the pandemic, the sedentary behavior is contributing to a lot of risk factors contributing to the NCDs. So we have to understand that behavior change will come about as a package and not as a single intervention. But having talked about behavior change and NCDs being tackled through healthy diets as an individual practice, we have to again understand that the obesogenic environment in which we all are living currently is another important area we need to think about. With the globalization of trade, urbanization, technologies, all of these are double-edged sword. They do lead to positive behavior health outcomes, but on the other hand, they also contribute to vulnerability to poor health. And that is because much of the behavioral choices, food choices, are dependent on what is available in the environment. As also rightly pointed out, sir, by you, parents do not have enough time to cook these days. Mothers are working. So ready-made food items, processed food, or something which is ready to eat becomes very convenient option. And that is where we also have to understand what is available in the market. So policy interventions are very important, and they are most cost-effective interventions. So we should not lose sight of these determinants, because nutrition education and nutrition literacy has a lot of aspects which are within the health sector but also beyond the health sector. And the National Multisectoral Action Plan on Prevention and Control of NCDs very clearly lays out what each ministry should be doing to change this environment and make it conducive to support this behavior change which has come about. So we may be advocating about increasing fruit and vegetable intake, but if the costs are prohibitive, then we cannot expect any family to change to be using fruits and vegetable instead of processed food or instead of high fat food which are cheaper. Similarly, we need to tax the food which are high in fat, salt and sugar. We need to control advertising exposure. We have recently concluded a study where we saw that children channels have very high exposure to food advertising. So if they are being bombarded with these foods which are showing very attractive, unhealthy food, this becomes a stimulus to eat. And we need to understand that advertising exposure is under Ministry of Information and Broadcasting. So Health Ministry may not have any role in it, but they can make recommendations to Ministry of Information and Broadcasting to curtail these advertising exposure. Similarly, there are interventions on reducing salt intake in the foods available, eliminating industrial trans fats through development of legislation to ban their use in the food chain, reducing sugar consumption through effective taxation on sugar sweetened beverages. So these are WHO best buys. But in Indian context, we surely need to promote nutrition literacy and using nutrition labeling, because we do have FSSAI has come up with a policy on nutrition labeling which will be effective from January 2022, but enabling people to understand those nutrition labels and apply it to their food selection is also very important. So I would just like to draw attention of everybody to saying that yes, we do need to have individual interventions so that people are making the right food choices, but at the same time the food environment is very important, which is dependent on the food manufacturing industry. It is dependent on various agricultural ministries, INB ministry, and many other ministries which have important role on portion sizing, packaging sizes, and even in the grocery stores, it has been shown that when there are messages on picking the healthy food options, the kind of food choices made by people to purchase food is different as compared to those who do not see these health messages. The positioning of food at the counters, when you are at the payment counter and there are all the chocolates and confectionery there, you tend to pick up food there. So that is food positioning. Whether we should keep healthy food options at that. So these are some important aspects in the urban setup, definitely. But we also need to think about our rural setup, and both overnutrition and undernutrition together contributing to NCDs means we have to adopt a syndemic approach and look for common solutions so that we can address both overnutrition and undernutrition in our Indian context. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Arora. Since we are kind of overshooting our time, so I would try to, you know, kind of conclude it here. We got wonderful inputs from all of you and tried to understand that, you know, this big challenge which we, every family, every individual is dealing at some level with this new menace of NCDs. While, you know, at present we have seen our mind getting completely overwhelmed by the pandemic, actually this has also added this burden further. And what I would, you know, kind of be drawing as a conclusion that, and my message to the people who will be watching these videos and are watching and with us, that food gives life, food nurtures us, but at the same time, food can also kill us. And that's what the message is coming from all our experts today. And this is on us, as a society, as a family, as an individual, as a country, that what kind of choices we are going to make for ourselves, for our children, for our people, our family, when it comes to food. We have to take food, we have to eat 3 times in a day. Food is not something, it will not one intervention which you will bring once in a month, once in a week, once in a year, or once in a 5 year. It has to be consumed every day, all across your life, and that is why it has the maximum bearing on your health, on your well-being. There are choices for you to make. There are availability of good food as well. There is enough information, as our experts also highlighted. I think we may be lacking on a nutrition literacy, but at the same time, food awareness, health awareness is at the, I think it's in a way in its pinnacle, if I can say, at present. We all know today that hand washing, something which maybe the countries might have spent billions of dollars to bring this small practice of hand washing, today all of us, we you know, do that. So I think changing this scenario of NCD burden is also possible. As Dr. Yajnik said, that it's never too late and it's never too early. Any time can be the right time to start picking the right food, because let it be the source of life than death. Thank you so much, all of you, for joining us today on this morning. And we look forward to your consistent support in ensuring that the information about good food reaches to everyone, and we are actively contributing towards the making of a healthy India. Thank you so much.